morning students, today we are going to start the next section of the reproductive physiology, that is female reproductive system. In the last class we have learned about the structure and different aspects of male reproductive system. Today we are going to see female reproductive system. The main components of female reproductive system are two ovaries. In the case of male, it is a pair of testes. Here are two ovaries and also a female reproductive tract. Female reproductive tract, it consists of fallopian tubes, uterus and vagina, that you can see here. Ovaries are only one ovary we can see in this picture because it says side by section. Similar, one more ovary is present on the other side. And fallopian tubes also one pair, one on each side. In this picture we can see only one tube, and uterus is this one and vagina is this tract. These are the parts of the reproductive tract in the case of females. Then next we are going to study the structure of human ovary. Ovary are one pair, one on each side. Okay, shape and its size. They are flattened ovoid bodies. They are flattened as well as in oval shape, ovoid bodies. It is 4 cm in length and 2 cm in width. If we see, think about this color, it is pinkish gray in color. It is pinkish gray in color, and about its position, it is seen suspended from vertebral column. We can see here the end of the vertebral column. This ovaries are suspended from the vertebral column by mesovarium. Mesovarium is a ligament that suspending this ovary from the vertebral column, that I will show you in the next picture. And at the level of uterus, this mesovarium suspend the ovary from the vertebral column. Okay, this is the mesovarium, is a ligament that suspend this ovary from the vertebral column at the level of uterus. That position is very important. It should keep in the level of that uterus. That positioning is mainly done by mesovarium. Next, parts of the ovary. This is the ovary's cross section. It has a central portion called medulla. This is the medulla. And this medulla is consists of stroma of loose connective tissue. Stroma means it is a tissue itself, stroma. And what is the peculiarity of stroma? Stroma is a mobile type of tissue and it provides a matrix to suspend other forms of cells on it. Such type of tissue are called stroma. It's a loose connective tissue. And that stroma is rich in elastic fibers, blood vessels, lymphatics and nerves. That is about the middle portion, because the that means it is responsible for all the nourishment, everything, because it is in all blood vessels, the nerves, everything. And also it is a loose connective tissue that gives a suspension. It helps to suspend all other cells of the ovary. Next, outer portion is called cortex. Then we need to learn about cortex. Cortex contain ovarian follicles. These are the follicles. So, certain sacs, small sacs. Follicles means small sacs. Yeah, inside that sacs actually present ova. That ova surrounded by some layers of epithelial cells seen inside these follicles or small sacs. These are the small sacs. Be seen in the cortex of the ovary. And when these follicles mature, that matured follicle is called Graafian follicle. Mature ovarian follicle of mammal is called Graafian follicle. That can also be asked this for 1 mark question. Graafian follicle. And in the coming section, you will learn the detailed structure of the Graafian follicle. And now just hear the term. Graafian follicle is the mature ovarian follicle. Follicle means sac. Sac that carry the ovum. Developing ovum. Then if we examine an ovary microscopically, we can discriminate 4 regions. Which are that 4 regions? Germinal epithelial layer is there. Then a capsule of connective tissue is here. Capsule is a capsule of connective tissue. Then a stroma of connective tissue inside the capsule. Then ovarian follicles. These are the 4 regions we can see microscopically if we examine an ovary. Then we are going to see about the development of primary oocyte. Primary oocyte means the initial stage of the ovum, egg. How it develops, when it starts to develop, that all we are going to see now. Its initial form is called primordial germ cells. Is a very beginning stage of the development of human embryo. Then primordial germ cells we can see as red dots in this picture. It first appeared, when it first appeared, 3 weeks old human embryo. When the embryo reached 3 weeks old, the primordial, the initial term of germ cells means egg, the initial first stage of germ cells appear by the period of if the embryo attain the age of 3 weeks old. At that time the primordial germ cells start to make its appearance. And where it is appearing? In the caudal part of the yolk sac, almost this portion. The caudal portion, it is shown in another form here. It is the caudal part of the yolk sac that giving nourishment for the embryo. And at the time of third week, from the time of third week, primordial germ cells start to appear here. From here, it start to migrate. To where? To germinal ridge. Then what is germinal ridge? Germinal ridge is the initial developmental stage of gonad. It is the primordial stage of gonad. Primordial stage of gonad means in the case of female, it will be the ovary. It is the beginning stage of ovary. Primordial stage of ovary. That primordial germ cells start to migrate to where? To the germinal ridge. That is the primordial ovary. At what time? By 5th week. By 3rd week it start to make its appearance. Then it migrates to germinal ridge by the time of 5th week. And the germinal epithelium start to proliferate, means grow. When it start to grow? By the 2nd or 3rd month of development. That means the ovary start to further develop. That development starts by 2nd or 3rd month of development. And then that time, oogonia, the primordial germ cells, then initiates all the primordial germ cells initiates its prophase 1, because it need to at that time all the egg cells are in diploid condition, 2n number. So we need to reduce half the number of chromosomes before doing fertilization. Okay, so it need to undergo meiosis. So keep that point in your mind. Then we can return one more time back to here. Oogonia, that means it now stays in the germinal epithelium. Oogonia initiates its prophase 1. Meiosis consists of two level of division, meiosis 1 and meiosis 2. So, oogonia initiates prophase 1 of meiosis and becomes primary oocytes. When it happens? By the 4th or 5th fetal month, when that baby attain or grow up to 5th month size, 5th month age, 5th or 4th month age, what happens? That oogonia just started the prophase 1 of meiosis and stayed as primary oocytes in the ovary of that fetus that reached the age of 4th or 5th month. Then what happens? It remains in that stage itself. Until what time? Until that baby born and reach his or until that baby born and attain her sexual maturity. Okay. I think it's very clear to you. First, the oocytes exist as primordial germ cells and it appears, make its first appearance in the caudal part of yolk sac by third week. And by the fifth week, it migrate to germinal ridge and it start to proliferate by the month of second or third month of development. And as the baby passed to fifth or fourth or fifth month, it initiates the first prophase of meiosis, and became primary oocytes and arrested at that stage till the baby born and attain her puberty. Okay, at the time when a baby girl born, her ovary contain 4 lakh primary follicles carrying that primary oocytes. Okay, and by the time she attain her puberty, what happens? Among this 4 lakh primary follicles, only one start the meiosis, the remaining phases of meiosis. That means it is all the primary oocytes have arrested at the stage of prophase first. It restart the further phases and completes the first meiotic division and form a secondary oocyte and a first polar gonium that we know that these cells are forming as a result of first meiotic division. That happens only when that girl attains puberty, and that further pursual of that meiosis happen only for one primary oocyte. Okay, and as she reaches menopause means at that particular age, that girl or woman stops any further menstrual cycle. No further menstrual cycle happen in her life after that age. That age is called the menopause. So between that period, between the period of puberty and menopause, it's almost 30 to 35 years. Within that period, almost 400 eggs reach maturity among the 4 lakh primary oocytes. And what happens to the remaining primary oocytes? It degenerate. It's not regenerate. It's mistake. Degenerate and disappears within few years. And that degeneration of that follicle is called atresia. Is it clear? So whenever a baby girl born, Her ovary carries 4 lakh primary follicles carrying primary oocytes. When she attains puberty, one of the primary oocytes pursue the meiosis and mature. One primary oocyte per month during her menstrual cycle. And when that girl reaches the age of menopause, by that time, almost 400 eggs can reach maturity and all the other remaining will degenerate, not regenerate, degenerate and disappears. And the degeneration of the follicle carry that ovum, primary oocytes, are called atresia. Okay, next. Then we are going to see the development of primary follicle. How the primary follicle become a fully mature Grafian follicle, that we are going to see. Before that, we need to understand what is primary follicle. Primary follicle is nothing. It is a structure carrying an oocyte surrounded by a single layer of follicular cells. Such a structure is called primary follicle. What is primary follicle? It carries a single oocyte. And that single oocyte is surrounded by a single layer of follicular cells. Then we are going to have a simple understanding regarding ovulation. What is ovulation? This is the baby in the womb. In this stage, her ovary carries primary oogonia. It is before her birth. Her ovary carries primary oogonia or primary oocytes. And this primary oocytes, after some more time, it just started its first meiosis by starting the prophase 1 and become primary oogonia or primary oocyte. At that stage also, it is in diploid condition. And in that stage, it remains there inside the ovary. In what stage? Primary oocyte or primary oogonia stage, by just entered the prophase 1 of meiosis. Then the girl born with the her ovary carrying all primary oocyte whose first meiosis arrested at prophase 1 stage. Still it is diploid. Then what is happening? She attains her puberty. Then after reaching puberty, single ovum, about 4 lakh is present. Among that 4 lakh, single ovum mature. How? By completing the first meiotic division. As a result of completion of first meiotic division, what will form? Secondary oocyte and first polar body. At that stage, after that, that secondary oocyte enters second meiotic division and arrested at what stage? Metaphase 2. And during that phase, the ovum that reaches the metaphase 2 stage, that follicle carrying that much developed ovum is called a Grafian follicle, and it's ovulate. Ovulate means that ovum comes out the Grafian follicle by rupturing its wall. This happened there. Then after its expulsion, that second meiotic division, actually it is arrested at metaphase 2 before the time of ovulation. After ovulation, that second meiotic division will pursue only when that ovum is fertilized by a sperm. If it is not fertilized by a sperm, that ovum will degenerate after 24 hours of ovulation. So, whenever a ovum, secondary oocyte, is ovulated, it wait for 24 hours for get fertilized by a sperm. After getting it fertilized only, it can pursue the second meiotic division and continue the further development. Otherwise, it degenerates. So, we can see a video to show that ovulation. Okay.
The female gonad is the ovary. It has an outer part called the cortex and an inner part, the medulla. The cortex contains many large round cells called oogonia. All the oogonia to be used throughout the fertile life of a woman are produced at a very early stage, possibly before birth, and do not multiply thereafter. In the late
female, that oogonia cells are arrested and remain stay in prophase first as primary oocyte before the birth of the baby.
Fetal period, primary oogonia enlarge to form primary oocyte. At the time of birth, all primary oocyte are in the prophase of first meiotic division. These primary oocytes remain in the prophase until they begin to mature and are ready to ovulate. With each menstrual cycle, a few primary oocytes begin to mature and complete the first meiotic division.
As that girl reaches her puberty and just before starting her first menstrual cycle, that one among the 4 lakh primary oocytes, only one continue that maturation, meiotic division, and form secondary oocyte and first polar body and continue second meiotic division and reaches metaphase 2 and arrested there. And that stage, it ovulated. Ovulation is happening.
Shortly before ovulation, the first meiotic division of a primary oocyte produces two unequal daughter cells. Each daughter cell has the haploid number of chromosomes. The large cell which receives most of the cytoplasm is called the secondary oocyte. And the smaller cell is known as the first polar body.
The secondary oocyte is haploid. Primary oocyte is the diploid.
Secondary oocyte immediately enters the second meiotic cell division. Ovulation takes place while the oocyte is in metaphase. The secondary oocyte remains in the metaphase till fertilization occurs. The second meiotic division is completed only if fertilization occurs. This division results in two unequal daughter cells. The smaller daughter cell is called the second polar body. If fertilization does not occur, the secondary oocyte fails to complete the second meiotic division and degenerates in about 24 hours after ovulation. In each menstrual cycle, 5 to 30 primary oocytes start maturing, but only one of them reaches maturity and is ovulated. The remaining degenerate.
That's about the ovulation. Next up. Then we are going to see how that development happened for a primary follicle. How the primary follicle become a graafian follicle. This is the oogonia cell. Primary oogonia cells. It is first covered by primordial follicle cells. Primordial follicles cover this oogonia cell first. And that flattened cells appears as flattened this day. Later it become cuboidal. Follicular cells flattened. Follicular cells become cuboidal shape and form the primary follicle cell. This stage is called a primary follicle. Then what happens? Membrane. Membrane means it is a non-cellular transparent membrane. It develops around that ovum. That membrane is called zona pellucida. And that follicular cells start to proliferate. It increases in number. That is the next change happens. And that proliferation continues, and as a result of that proliferation, certain gaps start to appear in between that follicular cells, and the size of the gap also start to enlarge, and finally it form a large space. That space is called antrum. That term you need to notice, antrum. And that antrum is filled with a fluid called the liquor folliculae. It's called liquor folliculae. Okay. And it's a layer of follicular cells that cover that the outer, means there's a layer of follicular cells outer to the ovum. That layer of follicular cell is called membranous granulosa. What is membranous granulosa? That antrum is lined by this membranous granulosa. Okay, where is the fang sheet? It lines that antrum externally. And cumulus euphoricus. Cumulus euphoricus is the layer of follicular cells that suspend the ovum. The layers of follicular cells that suspend the ovum is called cumulus euphoricus at one side of this antrum. Okay. And those layer of cells seen on the other side of that ovum is called discus proligerus. What's its name? Discus proligerus. This is the layer of cells seen on the other side of that which layer of cells? Cumulus euphoricus. Discus proligerus. And next, externally to the follicular cell layer or that membranous granulosa, they present one more outer covering. It is called theca folliculae. This theca folliculae is composed of two layers, an inner layer and outer layer. That inner layer is called theca interna and the outer layer is called theca externa. And one more term is there. The membranous granulosa rests on a on another membrane called the basement membrane that I didn't mention here. Okay, these are about the structure. And at that stage, when all these structures develop in the primary follicle, it becomes a Graafian follicle, and inside that the ovum continues its first meiotic division and form a secondary oocyte and first polar body. And the other structures is not shown here, which is understood. And when that primary follicle develop all these structures, structures means till the theca externa, then it is called a Graafian follicle. Okay, we can see that video.
Primary oocyte.
These are all primary oocytes or primary follicles. The primary oocyte we can see inside, and it's covered by some substance. We can see they're called follicle flattened follicular cells.
This is 44 XX chromosomes. It is around 35 microns in diameter. As the follicle undergoes maturation, primary oocyte increases in size and reaches about 140 microns in diameter. The flat follicular cells now becomes cuboidal.
That flattened cell become cuboidal and form primary follicles.
Follicular cells multiply to form several layers of cells around the developing primary oocyte. Scattered amorphous material accumulates between the inner layer of follicular cells and the primary oocyte. This glycoprotein-rich material fuses to form a complete striated membrane called as zona pellucida.
And that zona pellucida is a non-cellular transparent membrane. It develops between the ovum and outer follicular cells.
It is derived from both primary oocyte and follicular cells. Numerous microvilli of the primary oocyte projects into the zona pellucida, where it comes in contact with similar processes of inner layer of follicular cells. It helps in transfer of nutrition to the developing ovum. The multiplication of follicular cells gains pace, and as
because as a result of the continuous multiplication of follicular cells, gaps are start to appear in between the cell, and later that size of gap will increase and form the end.
The result, small spaces appear in between the follicular cells. These spaces fuse with each other, forming antrum folliculi. It is filled with a fluid called as Leuker folliculi. The follicular cells, which forms the outer layer, is called as membrana granulosa.
Follicular cell, seen outer side of the antrum, is called membranous granulosa.
The follicular cells that intervene between the antrum folliculi and zona pellucida is known as cumulus euphoricus or cumulus ovaricus. Those follicular cells that suspend the zona pellucida and developing ovum constitutes the discus proligerus.
The discus proligerus means those cells that suspend that ovum and that zona pellucida. That layer of follicular cells is called discus proligerus. Discus proligerus actually that suspend that ovum. And also the zona pellucida.
At the same time, changes take place in the stromal cells of ovary surrounding the developing follicle. These stromal cells organizes to form a sheath known as theca folliculi. Theca folliculi consists of two layers. Theca interna, inner vascular and cellular layer. Theca externa, outer fibrous layer. At this stage, the primary oocyte completes the first meiotic division to form secondary oocyte and first polar.
Secondary oocyte and first polar body is formed inside this structure, and the whole structure is called a Graafian follicle.
Polar body.
Next, I think it's clear, very clear now how that primary follicle became Graafian follicle and what all the changes, different structures. Then we need to once more understand this different structures that are seen in the Graafian follicle, and for your university examination also, if that such question came, you need to point out all the point that I am going to tell about this Graafian follicle now. Antrum, we need to quote there. Antrum means fluid filled cavity seen inside the Graafian follicle. The Leuker folliculi means that fluid seen inside the antrum. Then membrana granulosa means layer of epithelial lining seen outside the antrum. Basement membrane means this membrana granulosa lies on this membrane called basement membrane. On this basement membrane lies this membrana granulosa. Theca folliculi is the outside membrane seen outside to the basement membrane. It consists of outer theca externa and internal theca interna. And one more thing, cumulus euphoricus. Cumulus euphoricus means mass of cells attached to one side of the ovum. Corona radiata. Corona radiata means inner cells of the cumulus euphorus around the or we can see here. Cumulus euphoricus. This is the cumulus euphoricus and its inner layer of cell. It is called corona radiata. Inner cells of cumulus euphoricus around the ovum. Then zona pellucida, we know, is a non-cellular transparent membrane outside the ovum. Then ovulation means the rupture of the follicle, discharging ovum into the coelom, means into inside the body cavity, because this is the ovary, and from the ovary actually that ovum develop, become secretory oocyte inside the Gayfian follicle inside this ovary, and it rupture, and that ovum is actually releasing into our body cavity. And during that release, don't letting it to fall on the body cavity, it is passing towards the fallopian that we can see in this video. The uterus, ovary, inside the ovary, follicle, primary follicle is going to become Gayfian follicle. Gayfian follicle of Gayfian follicle. By the funnel shaped end of fallopian tube, moving down to the fallopian tube. At that stage, it is arrested at the metaphase 2 of the second meiotic division. And during its passage through that fallopian tubule, it need to meet with a sperm and to get it fertilized, and after fertilized and just after started toward three some divisions, only then it moves and it get fixed in the uterus. Even if this much sperm attaches to this egg, only one sperm can cross the outer membrane of the egg and fertilize the nucleus. About ovulation and how it get fixed or implanted inside the wall of uterus. Up to there we have seen. Then we are going to learn about the fallopian tube. This tube. What is fallopian tube? It's a pair of tubes lies close to the ovary, but it's not in a direct contact with the ovary. And it opens into the abdominal cavity. C is missing here. Abdominal cavity very close to the ovaries. And its opening is funnel shaped. And at that opening, certain finger-like processes are present. It is called fimbriae. And the other end is attached and communicate with the uterus. Its opening, its cavity continues with the space inside the uterus. It's about fallopian tube. And as the ovum comes out, it passes through the fallopian tube. Inside the fallopian tube, that fertilization happens. After fertilization, certain number of divisions happen, and that divided embryo is actually moving down and get implanted on the wall of the uterus. Then regarding the uterus, what is uterus? It is a hollow, thick-walled, muscular organ, because we see initial stage is that much compact and constricted, and how much it can extend even to carry a human baby, that much size it can extend, that much it is elastic. And position, it is located between our urinary bladder and the rectum. This is position. And adding its parts, fundus is a broad portion, a wide area, it's the body of that uterus, and a narrow portion is present, is called cervix. There is a uterus, a broad portion is there and a narrow portion. Broad portion is called its body, it's called fundus. Narrow portion is called cervix. Narrow body is a lower portion. Then that narrow portion, this is the cervix, projects into the upper portion of vagina. Vagina is the tract to give passage for the penis, and that cervix is communicating with the upper portion of the vagina. Then we are going to learn about vagina. What is vagina? Vagina is a muscular canal. It is a muscular canal leading to the uterus and also to the outside. It opens outside also. And it's a copulatory organ of female. Copulatory organ means it helps the male reproductive structure to deposit the sperm. So it provides a passage for the disposal of sperm into the female's body. What about its length? Its length is 7.5 to 9 centimeter long. That much length is there for this vagina. And what about its wall? It is composed of smooth muscles. And its inner lining of vagina consists of some sensitive papillae. Papillae means small projections. And also consists of some mucus secreting gland. That name of that gland is called Bartholin's gland. It gives lubrication to the penis. And its secretions are acidic. Why it is acidic? Not to let any microbes to grow here. Otherwise, it provides some the environment good for the survival of some microbes. It may lead to have some infection for the uterus and all the internal parts. So, for avoiding that, secretions from the Bartholin gland is acidic. That acidic condition, the acidic environment is hostile for, I mean, hostile means it is not suitable for the development of microbes. In that way, it can avoid in development of infections. And that acidic acidic environment need to be neutralized when the time of disposal of deposition, the time of deposition of sperm, otherwise that sperm will degenerate or die. So to avoid that, semen is alkali. It neutralize the acidity of this secretion for the survival of the sperms. Then external genitalia. External genitalia of the female is called vulva. Position is immediately external to the vagina. It lies immediately external to the vagina portion. And its parts we need to understand. Mons pubis. Mons pubis is this area. In area we have some hairs. It's an elevated, rounded, fatty tissue area that cushions. It gives a cushion feeling for the underlying pubic bone. For avoiding any stress, it's a function of Mons pubis. The labia majora, labia majora means is a outer flap of fleshy skin to prominent fatty folds. It's a some fatty fold of skin, and it is seen outside of the outermost region of the vulva, and it forms the outer lips of the vulva. Then labia minora means it is also a fold, small fold of skin, that's seen between labia majora. Labia minora is a small fold of skin, again small fold of skin seen between the labia majora. Its function is to protect the urethra and the vaginal opening. Then vestibule. Vestibule means the area enclosed by labia minora is called vestibule. And it engulfs the hymen. Hymen means a thin membrane that closes the vaginal opening and also urethral opening. That is hymen. Clitoris. Clitoris, here we can say this is the clitoris. Clitoris is a structure similar to male's penis. And it is an erectile structure. Erectile means it is upon tactile stimulation, since it consists of so many sensory nerve endings. It is erectable. It can erect. And also that clitoris is covered by a skin called prepuce. And that hood-like prepuce skin is seen at the junction of labia minora. It's about the vulva. Then mammary glands. What is mammary glands? Mammary glands is an accessory organ in reproductive system. It is found in both males and females. It is a modified sweat glands. And in which region we can see these mammary glands? It extends from our second rib to the sixth rib. We know what is ribs. From the level of second rib up to the sixth rib, it extends and also extends till towards the axillae. Axillae means armpit. But lengthwise, it extends from second rib to sixth rib, and widthwise, it reaches up to the axillae. From axillae up to sternum. Sternum, we know, it is present on the central portion of the ribs of both sides. That's about its position. It extends from second rib to sixth rib in lengthwise position, and in breadthwise, it extends from armpit or axillae till to the sternum. That's about its position, and it is seen closely associated with the pectoralis major. Pectoralis major is a muscle. It's called chest muscle. Seen associated with this muscle, mammary gland is located. Then regarding its parts, areola. Areola means a pigmented circular pigmented skin seen in the mammary gland. And nipple is there. Nipple means a protrusion from the center of this areola. Areola, that pigmented circular area, its central portion has a protrusion. That protrusion is called a nipple. And from that nipple, numerous lobes irradiated. That lobes are called alveoli. And that alveoli are actually milk secreting cells. And from each alveoli, certain ducts are emanating. And these ducts are called the lactiferous duct. This lactiferous duct joined to form large lactiferous sinuses. And from inside the that lactiferous sinuses, image is with me, I will show you. This is an expanded view of the alveoli, one alveoli. Then this inside the alveoli, we can see a space, and it's called the milk duct. That space, this area carries milk, because that alveoli itself composed of many milk secreting cells. That milk secreting cells secretes milk to this space, and from this space milk is carried towards this duct, and that duct opens till towards the tip of the nipple. A lactation means the process of secretion of milk by the secretory cells of mammary glands. Okay, with this we can finish today's class and section. Thank you.